Imagine being a healthcare provider in rural New Mexico with patients facing complex problems such as hepatitis C. The experts and specialists you need are hundreds of miles away. Treatment means your patient must travel to Albuquerque, perhaps numerous times. But Project Echo at the University of New Mexico is changing that reality. I sat down with Director Sanjeev Arora to talk about how his team delivers expertise to patients no matter where they are. Dr. Arora, thank you for being with us to talk about Echo. I saw you at the TED Talk, along with our producer, Megan Kamrick. We ran outside and said, we have got to have Dr. Arora come in and talk to us about this. Let's talk about your program, Echo, first of all. And of course, you talked about Hep C and the problem here in New Mexico. Let's establish some groundwork. How large is the problem? How have we been going at this in the past? And why is Echo different, particularly to Hep C?
So hepatitis C is actually a worldwide problem. There are 170 million people worldwide with it. Very, very few people worldwide are getting treatment. Most live in developing countries. Mm-hmm. And one would expect 15, 20 million people to die from this disease. Mm-hmm. But in New Mexico alone, close to home, we have about 35,000 patients with hepatitis C here. Hmm. Because of the fact that treatment is very, very difficult, it requires a chemotherapy-like regimen. Mm. And just a few centers in New Mexico, mostly in the big cities, actually treat hepatitis C. Mm-hmm. At the University of New Mexico, we have one of the largest centers that treats hepatitis C. Patients have to travel very long distances to get treatment. And treatment is, as I said, like chemotherapy. You require weekly injections, mm-hmm. you require pills, you get lots of side effects,
wow.
fever, depression, low blood count, mm-hmm. that people often have to make 12 to 18 trips to New Mexico, to Albuquerque, to actually get one course of treatment for hepatitis C. So wow. if you're living in Silver City, mm-hmm. you would have to drive 200, 250 miles each way, 12 to 18 times to get one course of treatment.
I can't fathom it, doctor. There must be a low rate of success with that kind of barrier.
It is very low. The biggest problem is the vast majority of people, hepatitis C is a disease that affects poor people disproportionately. Mm-hmm. The vast majority of people just cannot afford to take that much time off work, right. The gas money. So when we started this project, ECHO project, less than 5% of patients in hepatitis C with hepatitis C in New Mexico had been treated. Mm. And they were coming to my clinic at a stage that was too late for treatment. People with hepatitis C die of one of two things. They either get end-stage liver disease, cirrhosis, and can die from complications of that, or they can get liver cancer.
My understanding also is that hepatitis C is the number one driver for liver transplants across the country. I did not know that.
That's more than half the patients who get liver transplants in this country today are due to hepatitis C. It is an extraordinarily expensive disease because when you do a liver transplant on a patient, it costs you $250,000 in the first year, and then costs somewhere between $50,000 and $100,000 a year from that day onwards for the rest of the life of the patient.
Wow.
So it's not a good option. The better option is to treat the disease and cure it. Mm-hmm. It's a curable disease. Mm-hmm. In 70% of all patients, we can give you medicines and cure the patient.
Mm-hmm. Now for us, particularly in New Mexico, I was struck during your talk about this that our prison population is particularly riddled with Hep C. Am I to assume correctly this is from perhaps needle use, lifestyle issues? What is the driver for our huge numbers of Hep C here in New Mexico?
The principal driver in the prison population is that they've had a history of intravenous drug use in the past. Mm-hmm. And what we find is that essentially we've been in collaboration with the Department of Health, the Department of Corrections here. We've been testing every single prisoner who goes into the prison. Mm. And what we find is about 40% of them have hepatitis C at entry. There, they could give it to each other. Now, very, very few people in the prison are treated. Mm-hmm. But the fact is, this is actually a community problem, because when they get discharged from the prison, they come out, and then there's a risk that they transmit it to other people. Mm-hmm. And also there is a risk for them to get end-stage liver disease. Mm-hmm. Of course, then subsequent treatments are extraordinarily expensive. There's a risk of death from them, mm-hmm. and so.
How does ECHO step into that breach, so to speak? What does ECHO solve in that idea of stopping something before it gets to a catastrophic place? What does ECHO fit in there?
So ECHO stands for Extension for Community Healthcare Outcomes. Mm-hmm. And the key question we asked was, is there a way that we could use technology to leverage the expertise that resides at a university setting? Mm-hmm. For hepatitis C, we needed a psychiatrist, a liver specialist like myself, a pharmacist. We need all three of them to be present, and mm-hmm. it's hard to get these three together in a rural area.
Sure.
So we said, could we leverage this expertise and treat hepatitis C everywhere in New Mexico? And the way we did that was we set up centers of excellence for treating hepatitis C in 21 different sites in New Mexico. 16 of them were in community health centers, mm-hmm. federally qualified health centers, 5 in prisons. And since there were no specialists there, we said we would have a primary care clinician, like a family physician or an internal medicine doctor, a nurse practitioner, a physician assistant, be the leader of that center of excellence. They would need a nurse or a medical assistant to be their partner. Mm-hmm. And that we would train them using video conferencing technology, much as you use on television, mm-hmm. to create knowledge networks. So ECHO is based on 4 key ideas. The first is we would use technology to leverage expertise. The second is we would use best practice protocols. So we have a best practice way of treating at the university. We said we'll all 21 of you would use exactly the same protocol. Mm-hmm. The third challenge we faced was, how do we make a primary care clinician who's never undergone a fellowship training in liver disease or psychiatry, how do we make them expert enough to provide best practice care in a rural area? We couldn't provide inferior care. Mm-hmm. And the answer that came was, we would use case-based learning. Case-based learning is the way I became an expert when I did my fellowship and residency at the university. And during that case-based learning, what happens is we co-manage patients with our mentor professors. Mm-hmm. And it is through this guided practice model that expertise is gained whenever you want to master a complex set of skills. Mm-hmm. An example is, if you wanted to teach your daughter to drive a car, mm-hmm. you wouldn't just give her a manual or a few lectures. You would sit next to her mm-hmm. and do guided practice. And that's how expertise. So we said we would do that, mm-hmm. and then we would use the internet to track outcomes. Mm-hmm. And so ECHO essentially is a very simple idea. Every week, we'd like to invite you to come and visit one of those sessions. Mm-hmm. We have these primary care clinicians from around the state join us on an interactive video network, all of them together. And one by one, they present patients of hepatitis C to us and my team at the University of New Mexico. And we discuss those patients in a de-identified way. Mm-hmm. No patient names are ever discussed. And we help them manage their patients in the rural areas itself. Mm-hmm. So we might go first to Espanola, then we might go to Las Vegas, New Mexico, mm-hmm. Las Cruces, Silver City. And over the course of 2 hours, we will discuss and co-manage about 12 patients.
Wow.
When we do this, a phenomenon, we call this a knowledge network. No patient ever comes on this network.
Right, right. What's interesting is, 2 things struck me reading about ECHO. I like this idea of the efficacy, to use that word that you use a lot in your paperwork, of those rural providers. You're actually taking those people and their associated staff to a completely other level, where they're able to then, at some point, if I'm following the plan correctly, they can actually start to fill in some of those blanks from the things they have learned through the course of this, and are much better advocates for their patients down in those areas. Am I correct in that as well?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. Gene. The key goal of Project ECHO is called force multiplication.
Okay.
This is a defense term. They've used it in the Department of Defense for different types of things. Mm-hmm. We have redefined it in healthcare as a logarithmic improvement in capacity mm-hmm. to provide best practice care for complex problems. Okay. That means 10 times or greater capacity. Mm-hmm. We couldn't do that just by giving them a fish every day. We are trying to teach them to fish. Mm-hmm. So what we found, as these knowledge networks continue week after week, mm-hmm. another phenomenon kicks in. We call it a learning loop, mm-hmm. that they learn from us, they learn from each other, they learn from are didactic presentations. Mm-hmm. They learn by doing, mm-hmm. and very rapidly, two things happen. The first is they gain enormous self-efficacy. Mm-hmm. They say, I can do this and I can do a really good job. That is essential ingredient to do something complex successfully.
Yeah.
The second thing that happens is they really become experts. Mm-hmm. And we actually studied that to demonstrate. We actually did a study which we published in the New England Journal of Medicine. Mm-hmm. I see you've read the paper.
I found it fascinating. Maybe I'm just a nerd. I found it fascinating because I have to say, the results were very interesting to me in your study, meaning I found that your success rate, or that there was a term about how to keep someone on a sustained program that you're trying to get to, the percentages were actually a little bit better than what you found up here at Albuquerque at UNM. What is the explanation behind that? It's obviously a very successful outcome for ECHO.
So the basic idea for doing this study.
What was that outcome, by the way, on the percentages, if you can just touch on that as well.
So what we found was that the outcomes were that for genotype 1, mm-hmm. the cure rate in the rural area was 50% mm-hmm. and was 46% in the university. And it was for genotype 2 and 3, which accounts for a third of the patients, it was 70 and 70%. So it was the same. Mm-hmm. And
did that surprise you at how well that worked out so quickly?
Yeah, so we originally did the study to prove that they could do it as well as the university. Mm-hmm. What really surprised us in the study was that the cure rates were much higher than when community gastroenterologists and liver disease specialists actually treat patients. Huh. And we have hypothesized that when you treat a patient close to their home mm-hmm. in a culturally appropriate setting by a team approach where they know and trust the doctor, mm-hmm. who often knows their language, mm-hmm. they don't have to travel long distances, and it doesn't cost them a lot of money to travel. Mm-hmm. And then at the university, you get a multidisciplinary team of experts helping you as opposed to just one specialist.
Right.
That actually care is better than when you see a specialist alone. And the reason is, these are very complex diseases. No one specialist actually has the expertise enough. The second is, what really determines success of treatment, which in this case is a cure of the virus. Mm-hmm. The only effective success is we permanently cure the virus. And if somebody has scarring of the liver, if you cure the virus, there is a 93% reduction in the likelihood of dying from hepatitis C, and a 70% reduction in essentially the likelihood of getting a liver cancer. So very successful outcome if you cure the virus. But the real determinant of cure mm-hmm. is adherence to medicine.
Right.
These are very toxic medicines. You need support mm-hmm. locally.
Yep.
They can't come to Albuquerque here and expect a university specialist to support them when they're having side effects in the evening.
Mm-hmm. That's a very key point. I appreciate that, because I remember reading something about it costs this country billions on Medicaid alone from folks falling off their medications schedule within 30 days.
Yes.
And there's a certain percentage that's guaranteed to fall off, and it's a huge problem for our country. It's interesting to me the success you've had with Hep C, because it seems clear to me from reading your research, not only do you find this an applicable outcome or system for other chronic illnesses here in New Mexico, but you're thinking now globally, doctor. You're thinking this could be a help cure for all kinds of chronic illnesses. What's the kind of feedback you're getting from other folks around the world? Are folks looking at this at ECHO and starting to buy into what's happening here?
Yeah, so the first step was to expand to other diseases, and we described mm-hmm. six criteria. We said if the disease is common, mm-hmm. if management is complex, mm-hmm. if new treatments are available, if there's bad outcomes for doing nothing, and there's a high social impact and effective treatments exist, mm-hmm. then you could use this model. So now we do, in New Mexico, we do it for HIV. Mm-hmm. We do it for substance use disorders, integrated addiction, psychiatry, mental health disorders, chronic pain, rheumatology, like joint rheumatoid arthritis and diseases of that nature, and many other diseases. As ECHO became successful in New Mexico, mm-hmm. the first step that happened was other universities in the United States wanted to replicate it. So University of Washington, mm-hmm. University of Utah, University of Nevada, Harvard University, University of Chicago. Many of these universities now have their own ECHO programs, and we teach them how to do it, because our mission and vision for our team at ECHO here is to improve healthcare all over the world. So we train all these people to set up their own ECHO projects, and they've done it successfully. Subsequently, the VA system came to us. The VA has 150 hospitals around the country, which takes care of veterans, millions of veterans. And now they have set up 11 ECHO projects in different regions, which are connected to 400 clinics, the veteran clinics all over the country. And lastly, about a year and a half ago, the Department of Defense came to us, because they have a problem with getting best practice care worldwide, because our forces are everywhere in the world. And so we are have a worldwide collaboration with them for replication of ECHO in the Department of Defense. We call it DoD ECHO. And in other countries now, Canada is setting one up. In India, we have three ECHO projects. Uruguay, we have one. And many other countries are in line to set up ECHO projects right now.
I can't congratulate you enough, Dr. Arora. I'm blown away by this New England Journal of Medicine research you published and other things in a state that we are hungry for results here. Let me just be very frank. We need results on many healthcare issues here. And I have to say, your program is the first one I've heard in a long time that has such startling results so quickly. I'm dearly hoping our legislature sees it. I'm dearly hoping all the power brokers here in New Mexico see it and support you. I understand you are getting money from our legislature, and you can prove a point to others that we keep this going. It would be really terrific to see. Could you come back and see us at some point and keep us updated on the progress over time? That would be really terrific.
I'd be delighted to do that, Gene, and thank you for the invitation. I wanted to mention to you that the New Mexico legislature has been extraordinarily supportive of this project already, and they continue to find that it'll be beneficial for the people of New Mexico.
Good for you. Thank you, Arora. Thank you. Thanks for coming to see us.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.